lot cheaper if you're going to pay for it. But also you get to cut out all the middlemen, and you get to cut out, you know, people like publishers or record labels. If you need them to market your content and get it out there for you, great, well then you cut them in. But if you're able to do that yourself, you can charge that much less, and it's not a problem, because even though you're charging right less, you're getting 100 piece, you get 100% of like a small pie as opposed to 25% of a bigger pie, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah?
So are you suggesting that the fetish object is kind of removed from human beings' desire pantheon?
I'm happy you put it that way. I guess so. I think the fetish object is a really sick symptom of a consumer society, because really what content is about, it's about ideas. Whether it's music, whether it's visual arts, what it is content relates, it communicates an idea. And that's all that matters. You know, an idea is kind of like a virus. An idea is the only, there's nothing quite like it except for viruses, because they actually infect people. And once you've been exposed to an idea, you can't be unexposed to it. So yeah, I'd say remove the fetish object. Let's just focus on the content and the ideas it gets across.
I think for collectors, particularly music, the fetish objects, the really cool artwork, that will always be desirable commodity for the collector.
Yeah, and there'll always be collectors, and especially they're going to become more like antique collectors, I think. Because you have a generation growing up now that is going to have less of these physical objects. They're never going to develop that neurotic, obsessive hoarding habit. Because, like, frankly, why do I want to collect?
Oh, I don't know. You got a kid. You know how they cling on to toys. That obsessive hoarding.
Yeah, but they also outgrow it if we don't foster it. Well, you know, I want an original copy of the White Album because of what the White Album was, right? It was a beautiful thing. But if it was never printed on anything, there'd be nothing for me there to own. Yep.
I have a question. For pieces of content that require a lot more production, do you also advocate something, giving it away for free or in charge?
Well, I wouldn't want the doctor doing heart surgery on me to abuse the free textbook. So, you know, I think but we're not dealing so much with ideas, we're dealing with facts, science, training.
But even not like that, I mean, entertainment pieces are relatively high-end production as well, like stuff that costs, you know.
Well, I guess it would vary from on a case-to-case basis. Like I said, you know, people will probably always charge for some kinds of content. I just think the overall price point is going to come down a lot because the physical plant production scale thing is no longer there.
Do you have any examples of higher-end content that is for free or has used an almost free business model that I could look at as well?
If you could grab my email off the slide and email me, I'll send you a few links later. I got to think about it. I'm actually a little hungover and foggy in the head right now. So. You do? Yeah.
There's actually a friend of mine. He's an author. His name is Scott Sigler. For 5-6 years now, he's been basically releasing all his books in audio form as a podcast for free. But he also has a publishing deal. He's become a New York Times bestseller. But he also has his own imprint, so he is selling stuff. But he's giving away the audio version of it for free. Okay. And his living is based off of writing, so that's all he does.
What's
the name? Scott Sigler. Sigler.
Another one would be, there's a lot of concerts that are happening that way now, where they're online concerts, but they're massive bands that are doing them, and you can view them, see them, partake in these concerts that used to be, you had to buy a ticket to go, and now you can just log on to YouTube and watch them, right? Well, and not because somebody took it with their camera, but the band actually chose to do that. And then, I guess, just back to the hoarding comment, I would disagree that they don't hoard stuff. I teach college students, and if you look at their laptops or their tablets, they hoard. It's just not physical. But their tablets are so congested with music and books, and so they are hoarding. We just don't see it in a physical way. So they are collectors. They are doing the exact same thing. It's just different.
So the fetish object has gone into the cloud, basically.
Yeah, it's still there. It
makes sense.
I worked with Jane Sivri late last year for her digital release of her new album, and she wasn't going to do a physical release, but the fans kind of demanded it, so she put it out, and it was a pretty expensive CD, but the fans kind of wanted it, and the digital wasn't reaching everyone. Like, people would wait for a physical release, but rather listen to it in their own sort of
Well, I guess I'm just curious to see what happens when you have a the youngest generation right now, when they grow up where more and more stuff, no longer, it's rather having a physical release is a rarity or uncommon, if that kind of market demand or that fetishized desire will grow up with them. I'm not so sure it will.
I think you're right. It will end up being a case where people function as collectors, but not so much as antique collectors. It'll go back to being the age of, you know, books are really expensive simply because you don't print as many of them, but the content for you to use is still available, you know, somewhere in the quality to access it.
I don't know if you covered it, I came in late, but the freemium model where Nine Inch Nails used this, where they, you could download some of their content for free, or you could buy it on a copy, and they had various packages where you could get like a CD and a record and a t-shirt for, you know, $100, or you could just get the CD for $15 or whatever it was that you wanted.
I didn't cover that at all, actually, but it's a great example of how people are mixing like low cost with free. And yeah, I think that's because free is one of your best marketing tools. If you make a certain amount of content available for free, a demand, and it's good content, it does generate a demand for the rest of your content.
Do you have any kind of rule of thumb for like pricing, like low pricing of ebooks or anything like that?
Go to the Kindle store, and there's a whole bunch of different books that about how to figure out the price point of your ebook. See which one sold the most copies or has the best rating and try it. I haven't figured it out. I just want to say anecdotally, when I released my ebook, I placed it at $2.99 because that was the minimum at which I could make a 70% commission. And after a few months, you know, sales started kind of stagnating, so I dropped it to 99 cents to see what would happen. And at this point, enough copies had been sold that it was getting recommended by the recommendation engine. And at 99 cents, it didn't move any more copies at all. So I kicked it back up to $2.99 and sales started again. So there's also, I think the current generation has actually been trained to see, it's a question of value. Like if it's free, is it really any that good? But yeah, there's a certain minimum. I don't know, I'm thinking of like kicking it up to $10 and see what happens for a week, but I have no idea.
That might actually work because for the exact same reason you just
also, it's only 48,000 words. I would feel bad charging $10, $15 for something that's actually technically only half a book. And I was done my story at 48,000 words. I didn't feel the need to flush it out because it was a digital thing.
At that point, you get, you know, a really nice long edition and just send it off to them and figure out the price.
Maybe. Sounds like a lot of work. Yeah?
Excuse me. I don't have the URLs or the author's names top of mind, but there was one author, he wrote a very detailed blog of exactly step-by-step what he did. There's a Kindle partner program something, and what he did, he was able to give his book for download for free for a fixed number of days. And what Kindle, Amazon
is... the Kindle Select program.
Okay, so...
Yeah, what happens is if you promise to make your ebook exclusive to the Kindle store and no other ebook store, you qualify for this program.
Right, and but that in and of itself wasn't enough. What he discovered accidentally is that after when the book is free, in his genre, there wasn't very many books, so it just appeared when people were looking for it. So in his little niche, suddenly, you know, the book is there, everyone downloads it for free. But what Amazon does is that after the free download period is over and he went back to his 99 cents, it still shows that people who bought this
also bought,
even though the distinguishing between free and paid download is not shown by Amazon. So that sort of became this big feedback thing. There were thousands of people that downloaded his book for free after the free period and still within the exclusive 90 days from Amazon. The licensing that they asked, that you remove it from everyone else's books, online bookstores, it just sort of triggered, well, I'm going to buy that because all these other people bought it.
Right, and they bought stuff that I was also interested in.
And the last, just one last thing is that his conclusion was he made a video for his book, his Twitter, his Facebook, everything else brought almost no sales. It was just this tactic of listing his book for free for a number of days and then Amazon's decision of doing that. So that was really counterintuitive, but he's made almost 100,000 now.
No, it actually makes perfect sense, and I think that's what the Amazon Select program is. It's giving sub-publishers or online publishers the tools to actually get a little bit of virality and create that. Also, it's a move to, because the condition of using it is to be exclusive to Amazon, they're trying to kill off the iBook store and the Nook store and so on and so forth. And I gotta tell you, like, I published my ebook on through all those sites. I've like sold 4 copies through all the other sites. All my other sales have been through Kindle. So yeah, it's definitely a powerful tool. And that recommendation engine is one of the best, that algorithm is one of the best marketing tools I think an ebook publisher has if they decide to publish through Kindle. Yep.
So then, we're moving more towards content becoming a utility, like water or electricity, something that you turn on or turn off, but this is there all the time?
Well, content always was a utility. It was to communicate something, right? For example, Socrates is rumored to have never written anything down because he never learned how to read or write, because he figured if he did, it would ruin his memory. And just like we have stopped remembering how to do small things because we can always Google it, and Google it, or the internet has become a utility. Yeah, I think content has always been a utility that way. I think I'm supposed to be out of time now. I don't know. I'll be hanging around if you want to chat. Thanks for coming out.
I was going to